Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
Our podcast today is on medications to treat obstructive sleep apnea. Is the future here? As all sleep providers know, CPAP is not for everyone. Alternate therapies such as oral appliances and surgery have variable efficacy. Many patients ask us if medications are available to treat this disorder. Is this possible? Is the future already here? To discuss this important topic, my guest today is Dr. Eric Olson, a board-certified sleep specialist and professor of medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Eric, the prevalence of obesity in the United States is estimated to reach 50% by 2030, and of course, obesity, as we all know, is a risk factor for sleep apnea. So let's start with the exciting news that tirzepatide, a GLP-1 agonist, has recently become the first drug that the FDA has approved for the treatment of OSA. This approval was based on the SURMOUNT-OSA trials. Could you tell us a little bit about the structure of those trials and the inclusion criteria?
Yes. So SURMOUNT was actually a combination of two trials. Both involved patients with moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea, defined by an apnea-hypopnea index of 15 events per hour or greater, and obesity. A BMI of greater than 30 in most of the sites, but 27 or greater for those enrolled from Japan. So these were two trials, multi-center international studies, and patients were randomized to receive usual care for obesity, and either placebo or tirzepatide, which is a GLP-1 GIP agonist. And the patients were then followed for a year, with the main endpoint being impact of weight loss by the drug on the apnea-hypopnea index.
Good. So tell us, what were the results? I think, you know, there are always multiple results in these trials. I think our listeners will be particularly interested in what percentage of participants were able to decrease their AHI either to the gold standard of less than 5 or less than 15 without sleepiness. In other words, an Epworth sleepiness scale of 10 or less.
Yeah, excellent. So if you look at both trials, trial 1 and trial 2, the percent weight loss was about 20%. And with that, the impact on the apnea-hypopnea index was about a 50 to 60% reduction in the AHI, which is fantastic. If you take that endpoint that you mentioned, which is what percent of patients achieved an apnea-hypopnea index below 5 events per hour, or an apnea-hypopnea index between 5 and 14 events per hour and an Epworth less than 10, it was 50% when you combine trials 1 and 2. So very exciting findings.
That is very exciting. Now, tell us, were these positive results dependent on weight loss, or is there some independent effect? You said the average weight loss was 20%, which is quite amazing.
Correct. So if you take trial 1, so those were patients that had the moderate to severe OSA and had never used CPAP. That group lost 18% of their body weight. If you take group 2, which are patients who were concurrently using CPAP while they were either receiving placebo or tirzepatide, they lost 20%. So both groups entered with an average BMI of 39, and so the weight loss was striking, and what we would see in non-sleep apnea patients who are treated with tirzepatide. And again, the impact on the AHI was about 3 times in terms of reduction of what we saw with the BMI reduction. So very, very high impact on the AHI by any weight loss that was achieved.
And the implication is that it was the weight loss, which
resulted.
There's no suggestion of any independent effect of tirzepatide.
Correct. It looks to be like the weight loss was the mechanism by which the apnea improvement occurred.
Okay, so now we understand the trials. Let's go to practical issues. I know this is impossible to predict with any certainty, but using your experience and your crystal ball, do you predict that insurances will cover tirzepatide or other GLP-1 agonists for the combination of obesity and sleep apnea in the absence of diabetes? Is this going to be lifelong coverage? Or are they going to cut it off after a year? And what do the studies show might happen if they cut it off after a year?
So this is a really difficult area to predict because right now coverage for tirzepatide or any of these anti-obesity medications varies dramatically from a certain time in which they will be covered, a certain amount of money they will be covered until that limit has been reached, or no coverage at all. I think given the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea and its impacts on so many aspects of health, I don't see how it won't be covered at some point by insurance. What remains unclear is exactly what those details will be. But I think the Surmount data are so exciting, and there's so many people out there struggling with CPAP that there will be coverage. But what exactly that will look like is unclear. The problem is the duration, one of those areas of uncertainty, because we do know from many studies that patients who stop these anti-obesity medications will regain their weight. That's an almost universal phenomenon. So if the coverage is going to be focused on obesity and sleep apnea, it's likely looking at indefinite coverage would be necessary.
Well, okay. Now the next question is, you're a sleep specialist. Patient comes in with moderate or severe sleep apnea and says, doctor, I want to start tirzepatide. Should you be prescribing it, the sleep specialist? As I understand it, patients may need fairly intensive follow-up and we'd have to understand the drug and its side effects. Well, should we be taking this on or not? What do you think?
Well, I think some sleep specialists already are taking this on, but I think to make that decision, you'd have to be very clear about having the necessary components in place to do this. So number one is you have to have the ability to educate patients on a holistic weight loss approach. Weight loss is not simply from the medication. It has to be combined with proper dietary recommendations and activity recommendations. Number two, you'd have to have the procedures in place to handle all of the insurance issues that will come, because these drugs will often be denied, require appeals, and that has to be an area of support for the patients to successfully start the medication. I think third, the infrastructure in your practice would have to be in place to handle the longitudinal patient care, particularly the side effects that develop with these medications and providing support, most of those being GI, but they can be beyond that. And so having a proper infrastructure in the office or in the practice to be able to handle that support would be key. Now, many sleep practices are probably not geared up to do those things, but if there is a desire and those components of the practice, you know, can be supported and maintained, I think there may be a role for some sleep specialists to take this on and use that as part of their practice.
Oh, those are very wise cautions, not something to be jumped into by any means. And I think other practices may well decide to defer to the primary care physician or perhaps a nutrition clinic of some sort.
Well, I think the challenge, Mike, is that primary care is overwhelmed, as are our nutrition clinics. And so it may become a necessity, especially if you're in an area that doesn't have all those other clinics to take advantage of, where it may become a necessity for a sleep practice to take the prescribing of these medications on.
Difficult decisions that each practice will have to weigh very carefully. Well, let's change direction and discuss a very different combination of medications that's been studied in several trials, although not approved by the FDA as of yet. This is a combination of atomoxetine, a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, and oxybutynin, an anticholinergic agent, both postulated to dilate the pharyngeal muscles during sleep. Do these agents work? Can you summarize the results of phase 2 trials done so far?
So this is another exciting development. There have been a handful of studies looking at this combination. Several of those studies looked at just one night, what would be the impact of the AHI on just one night of treatment. But the most robust phase two study was what was called the Mariposa trial, which was a 1 month trial looking at several different doses of this combination and what the impact would be on the apnea hypopnea index after a month of therapy. And in essence, what the studies have all shown is about a 50% reduction in the apnea hypopnea index with this combination therapy.
Okay, so do you see this at present as a practical alternative for our patients? Or should we say, no, let's wait for the phase three trials and FDA approval? I mean, of course, we can always use drugs off-label. What in practice do you think at present? What advice do you give to practitioners?
I think it would be wise to wait for the phase three trials. They're two ongoing. They should be done and reported hopefully by mid-2025. And so I think patience is in order to wait for that data rather than embarking on clinical trials kind of individually in practice right now.
Thank you. That's wise advice. So this is really exciting times. Thank you for your knowledge and insights. Are there final messages, any of them that you would like to leave with our listeners?
Well, I think the exciting thing is that we are, I think, getting more on the verge of actually being able to use personalized therapy for obstructive sleep apnea rather than kind of a one-size-fits-all with CPAP. But I think even more exciting is that these new options are re-engaging people with sleep specialists who have sleep apnea but have struggled with CPAP and have thought, well, if that's the only thing I have, you know, why re-engage? So having more options, I think, is exciting for patients and it's exciting for us as sleep providers.
Thank you very much. We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you. Thank you.